So yeah, thanks again, everybody, for coming. This is really exciting. This is my third talk I gave with, one was kind of with the folks at Prezi on some generic FRP stuff, and then more recently I was in Oslo talking about WebGL. And so yeah, like I mentioned, if we want to, this is going to be really informal, if we want to get to WebGL at some point during the talk, it's on there. I can elaborate more on that. But kind of the goal is to give you guys just an introduction of like what the Elm story is, what it's all about, what it's trying to achieve, the problems it's trying to solve, and kind of how it goes about doing that. So yeah, that's pretty much it. A little bit about me. I live right here in New York City, and I currently work at Bridgewater Associates, which is a hedge fund up in Connecticut. And you know, similarly, we're always looking for great technologists. So if you want to learn more about that, come talk to me. I can give you guys a whole bunch of materials on that. Otherwise, I've been contributing to Elm for about 2 years now, and it's been pretty fun. Like I said, I worked on the WebGL and have just kind of been on the listserv, which is a really fun place to talk about, oh, well, what direction should the language go? It's this weird mix of theoretical and practical, and we're always trying to strike that right balance between, you know, making the right decisions from a philosophical standpoint, but also trying to make things not too difficult. And I know that's a little bit of a jab to the Haskell community, but I think a lot of people did move to Elm for two reasons. One, because they want to do stuff on the web, and they wanted it to do functional programming that was a little more lightweight, a little easier, and you don't always have to be mired down with the crazy type system and some of the abstractions that Haskell provides. Sometimes it gets a little much, so I'll talk about that a little bit. Right, so the Elm programming language, about 2.5 years old. It has a couple of things that really make it distinctive. The first is that it's a functional language that is on the browser, which really, I guess now you have Clojure Script, which is a pretty good contender, but I think Elm is also one of those it's also a statically typed functional language. And so I'm not going to get into like the whole argument of like why is static typing good or whatnot, but if you're into those sorts of things, that Elm's going to be pretty strong. The second thing is that the way you do graphics in Elm is kind of different than, at the time when it started, was really its own thing. The closest thing to it probably now is stuff like React and Virtual DOM, which we actually interface with now, and we'll talk about that also. But it's this idea of declarative graphics. You kind of re-render the whole scene at once. That sort of story. And so that gets pretty nice, especially in the context of functional programming. And then finally, which is what I think a lot of people are most excited about Elm, is the fact that it's reactive, the fact that it uses FRP, this functional reactive programming, which is a really cool way to think about how do I make the application change in response to whatever, like events or just changing inputs or whatnot. And so that, I think, has the coolest stories around that. So what makes Elm functional? Well, it's an ML family language, so it looks like Haskell, it looks like standard ML or OCaml, F sharp, I guess even. They're all kind of in the same bucket of what you could do, how you define functions. Again, statically typed, has all the type inference, so you don't have to put all those type annotations in there, though, you know, if you've been in this kind of area, you'd want to put the type annotations in there. And we go for, you know, pure functions. You write a function, you give it its input, you get the same output every time. There are no side effects. You know, this very predictable way of programming, and immutable data. This, you know, again, I'm not going to go through all the benefits of why some people like that. So I'm just going to show a pretty quick example that demonstrates the syntax. I think a lot of people who have written a functional program have seen like this idea of a Fibonacci program. So you start by saying, okay, this is my Elm module, a little bit of boilerplate, this is how you do comments, also pretty similar to Haskell if you've seen it. So that, a lot is borrowed there. And so we're gonna do the very inefficient, you know, what is, how do you compute the nth Fibonacci number? And so we're gonna have a function from that number to a new number, pretty simple. We're gonna pattern match on that number, and so the first is one, the second is one, and anything else is, you know, -1, -2. Is anybody here like brand new to functional programming? And this is like, because I can go into a lot of details of like what, okay, cool. So, right, so then everybody, I think this is pretty simple, and we can go on. And so there's this idea of, well, we wanna actually be able to see this, and so we can just throw it on the screen by using this neat thing called AsText, and we'll just consider that magic for now. But to prove to you that it works and it can compute basic number things, we're at that point.
How does that stop if 1 is equal to 1?
So fib 1, right, is going to be 1.
Oh, because it just, it is.
Yeah.
It,
right.
It goes through line 11, 12, and 13. And if 11 is true, then 12 and 13 never happen.
Right. So this is this idea of pattern matching, or this case expression. And so this is pretty common in all these, in the Haskell and the ML languages. Based on the input of the function, you just go down in order, pick which ones match. And you can either match on a guard, like something that is true or false, or you can just match directly on a value. And so this pattern matching directly on a value. We see that it's 1. Okay, it's 1. Awesome. So we could try a whole bunch more.
Crappy.
Yeah, oh, this is a terribly inefficient way to implement Fibonacci, right? If we were to put in like 100, I don't know if it would blow the stack or would just take a really long time. Yeah, so this is just going to take a really long time, so we're not going to, we're just going to. Great. Okay, cool. Oh, I didn't put arrow keys in there. All right, and so like Haskell, we have a couple of ways of declaring types. We have these two different worlds. We have this world of types, like what is the shape of our data, and values, which is like the actual data itself. And so because it's statically typed language, this is kind of in our minds when we're programming. And so there are two ways to think of data. There's this idea of sum types and this idea of records. And then you get all your primitives like integer and string and everything. And I'm going to gloss over that. I'm like, how do you define your own, how do you model your own data? And so there's two ways. You kind of have this, what's sometimes called a union type, an algebraic data type, a sum type, an enumerate. On the list, we had a big debate on what are we really going to call these things, and I don't know what we decided, so I just put all the names up here to give you guys as much of an intuition of like, well, what is this thing? If this is new to you, it's this idea of, well, if I have something which is a fur color, it's not just like anything. It's one of these distinct, this finite set of things. So in this case, I'm saying, well, fur color can be either one of black, brown, orange, gray, white. Not like any combination of them. No other values. Red, can't have red cats.
What's the difference between that and saying enum?
It's very similar to enum. I don't have an example here of where it's a little more complex, but I can give you an example of.
You can add constructors.
Yeah, so those are all constructors with like zero arity constructors.
Right.
You can think of it that, right? Exactly.
You can add additionals to make them more complex.
Yep. So, string, list of bool or something, right? And that would be a valid type, I think. Yeah, great. And so, like, you could say, well, I can have a foo, and a value of type foo is either a bar, which has an integer, or a baz, which has a pair of a string and a list of booleans, right? And so it's a little more extended from an enum. However, if you look at a language like Rust, they call this enum. So, like, all these languages are kind of converging on this idea of let's define data in terms of finite sets, and every language has a different name for it, so it's not important, but the concept is the same. The second way to define complex data is this idea of a record, which is similar to a C struct, but a little more different, and I have an example of how it could be different. But in this case, it's just like you got a couple of names, and you have a couple of fields, and each one of those fields has a certain amount of data. So in this, every cat has a name and a fur color. That's it. It's just a record. It's just like a bag of data. That's it. And so in this case, a value of type cat, and I can actually...
Do you get helper functions automatically?
That's a good question. So the way you just dot pattern access it.
Right, but in the sense of like, lore of records versus algebraic data type is you get helper functions.
Yeah, yeah. So you, well, yeah, but they look like this. They're not really. Actually, you do also get a function.
For access.
That looks like this, dot name. I think that's it's a prefix function that is actually called dot name, and so that kind of works the same as the Haskell records.
Okay.
But it's not exactly the same story. But yeah, you get the same kind of thing, right? You get this way to destruct a record by calling into a specific field and pulling that part of the data out. Right, right. So this I changed it to just say Tom, but if I pull back or Tom's name versus the actual the entire piece of data. So yeah, pretty similar, pretty simple. I'll go into it pretty quickly. The records in Elm are pretty cool because they're also extensible records, and so we can write functions that expect the record to have certain fields, but you don't have to know exactly what the whole record is. And so we can say something called magnitude is a function from any record that has an x and y integer values. And so magnitude, I mean, it's x squared plus y squared, but I'm going to say x plus y because I'm lazy, right? And to demonstrate this. And then I can say, well, what's the foo equals the magnitude of a record that has x equals 1 and y equals 2 and the cat equals Tom, right? So this here is my value, and it's a record, and it has three fields, an x and a y and a cat. But because it has at least an x and a y, it's compatible with this function magnitude. This is what's called an extensible record, and this is the syntax that goes along with it. And I'm just going to compile this to make sure I can actually... Yep. It's like an anonymous value. So this is actually very poorly written because it's completely incomplete. Magnitude of r and then r dot x. I'm sorry, yeah. So that's why it's nice to have static typing, because you can fix your live demo. So this is, right, so you get, so magnitude is a function that takes a record, any record that has at least an x and a y field, which are integers, produces an integer, and then this is how it does it. It takes the record and just gets its x and y field, and right, so it would actually be x squared plus y squared, but we're skipping over that. And then so we're saying, oh, what's the magnitude of this guy? And then we'll just call that, and so we get what we expect, we get 3. So extensible records, really cool. We're thinking of ways of kind of emulating type classes with extensible records, because we don't have type classes in the language right now. And so we're looking at ways to exploit extensible records as much as we can without adding extra features to the languages. And so we're coming up with some cool stuff.
Can you intersect two records so that you get, you know?
That's a good question. No, not currently. It's one of those things that's been like thrown around, and how can we do that safely? When should we allow it to keep the type system sound? But I think it would be a good thing to add. A good thing to add in a couple of ways, which is kind of get like the union of two records to a bigger record type,
yeah.
Right? To be able to do like monad transformers or something like that, or the combination of constraints. Yeah, exactly. It'd be pretty cool. Kind of. Yeah, you can think of it that way. Right, so good question. It can be used to do that. It can be used to do lots of other things too, but that's a common way to think of it. I'm expecting some data that has at least these things, right? And it probably has more. It might have nothing extra, right? So this could be like, well, if I just have the fields X and Y, that's still valid, right? That's the empty record plus those two fields satisfies the instance of a record that has those two fields. You see what I mean? Right.
But I didn't follow what you wrote.
Uh-huh. Okay, right. So the original question was, can you use extensible records as a way to like constrain the inputs of a function?
I'm trying to understand if that's what they are. So if they're more than that, then...
So I think the answer is they're more than that, but that's a great way to use them. Right. Cool. So data and records, that's kind of how we define our data, and pretty much anything you want to model, I mean, in my experience, can be pretty much covered by structs and these algebraic data types. Cool. So let's talk about graphics. The story about graphics in Elm is largely, Evan was
obsessed.
Yeah, sure.
Tuples?
Yeah, tuples are in there. I think we did a tuple here.
Right.
So yep, they're a primitive type. And I think we have like up to 10
essentially
or something.
With numerical.
Yeah. I don't know how far. I'm not actually sure. It might break if you have like a tuple of 11 elements. I don't know what the compiler can actually handle. And if it does break, that would be a great issue and a great pull request for anyone who's interested. but yeah, so we've got tuples for pretty much any size you realistically need, I think. And so yeah, they're in there. Right, so graphics. Graphics was largely, Evan was upset with the DOM and HTML and everything about it and said, I'm going to redo all of it. CSS, he didn't like it. He just everything about the way that, I mean, there are good philosophical reasons of like why you have your content and you got your styling and you got your JavaScript, right, or whatever you call it. And but he wanted a different way to sort of build up, to define what an element looked like. And I think a lot of it was just forced upon him because of he really wrote the language to do this functional reactive stuff, and so. Well, we needed a way to write declarative graphics using pure functions that eventually you get this thing that can be rendered on the screen. And so that's what this element type is. If you have a value of type element, the language runtime understands how to render that onto the screen, how to make that appear, how to turn that into DOM that the browser can display. And so there are only certain ways that you can create something of the element type, and they all come in the standard library. It's not entirely true. You can actually write a native library that does the same thing, that provides you a function in Elm and creates some underlying JavaScript thing that knows how to render itself. But the idea is that there's this element type, and if you have something of a type element, it knows how to render itself, or it either encapsulates it, or the runtime itself already knows how to render that kind of thing. I probably made that more complicated than it needed to be. and so the only way you can make elements is from these pure functions, so it forces you to be declarative. And we'll go through some examples. Declarative and constructive, there's this sort of building block idea of I have an element and I can make more elements by, you know, putting them on top of each other vertically or putting them horizontally or stacking them in front of each other or stuff like that. And I took the clock example off the library because I don't want to introduce like reactive stuff just yet. So I'm just going to say a broken clock, which is correct twice a day. We'll just kind of look at how that works. And so this is the code to draw a clock, and we'll go through it line by line. You can see here at the end, main has type elements. And so that is just kind of the way all Elm programs are. They have a type element. Slight caveat, we'll get to that later, but currently it's just element. That way it knows how to render itself. And, you know, in a browser, it's not like main is, you know, void unit or whatever. You're not really running anything. It's like, well, what appears on the screen? That's all the browser is. It's a display. So I have this function clock, which takes a float. I don't know what this is, probably Unix epoch or something, and makes a clock. And it does this by instantiating a collage. You can actually look at this, and this is a big canvas of 400, 400, just to show you guys what's actually happening under there. And in the collage, we have a list of forms, which is something like element, but has a different way of kind of moving things around. It's more of like an XY coordinate system and more of shapes and stuff. And so we've got this big 12 gon, and then another one with an outline with a different color, so you can sort of see, right, it's got this border. This is probably the radius. You know, so again, this is where the declarative, I don't want to go so far as a DSL, but you know, these libraries of building up these shapes and these elements, it all comes in here. They're all pure functions, and they all give you things that can be drawn. And so this is a cool way to build up your stuff. And then we have three hands. And you can see, okay, this is the minute hand, and this is the hour hand, I guess. Yeah, 60 times 12. And so hand is it's another function that we have. And so composability, modularity, awesome. It just takes a color. It takes, I guess, a length, and I guess an angle, and it gives you this form. And you can see this is just a line segment that starts at the origin. We convert it to polar coordinates, and we trace a line with solid color. Like it reads like it kind of makes sense. And you can hit the API and see exactly what the function, the type signatures are for each of these. But it's like, oh, we're just building up these shapes from primitives in the standard library and throwing them up there, and we get our clock. I think it's probably a good time to show where all this comes from. And in the standard library, we have this collage library, which here's your essentially the canvas making function, but don't even think about canvas. This collage has its dimensions and the stuff to draw, and it gives you an element. And that's what we get. And then you got all these things like moving things around and grouping them and making all of your basic shapes, lines, line styles. So a pretty comprehensive way of just like whatever kind of stuff you want to show, you can draw it. Anyway, it's just compared to the Canvas Direct library, which is, I don't know, set color and draw a line from point to point and everything, it gets pretty nice. And it's functional, and it has static types and everything, so the benefits just compound, right? So any questions about kind of how this is structured? Yeah?
So the syntax where you have a type name and a type name, you know, error.
Yeah.
Everything before the last arrow is permanent, and the last arrow is a permanent.
Right, yeah. And so...
that looks very arbitrary, but it's actually not.
Right, exactly. So what is the reason why it looks like that and not just like a color and a float and a float? And so we can actually define a new function called orange hand, which is just a float to a float to a form, and orange hand equals, and it's just hand orange, right? Because orange is a value of type color, and that's it, right? We could say that. We could also say, you know, F1, F2, and F1, F2, right? So now you can kind of see that, okay, well, orange hand has two parameters, float, and form, and okay, here's this argument, and then this is calling the hand function, but we can actually just pull these out. It's a technique called partially applied functions, and so we can give it like two. If you have a function with n arguments, you can give it anywhere from 1 to n arguments and get either the eventual value or just like a new function that takes only some of the parameters. Does that make sense? So yeah, so it's called partially applied functions. It's pretty cool. I didn't go into it because it's like I guess an intermediate, but it's pretty handy, especially when you can imagine places where you might want to have a helper or something like that, or if you have something with like 6 parameters, but like the first 3 are really all you're using at the time, and so you use that throughout your program.
F-sharp has the same thing.
Yeah, F-sharp's got this, Haskell's got this. I would imagine OCaml and Standard ML also both have this.
Yeah.
JavaScript.
I don't think JavaScript has this.
No.
Does it now?
Sort of?
I honestly don't know, so.
It does.
Yeah. Does it?
Yeah.
You have to spell out what you want.
I see. Okay.
But what?
It actually returns a new function?
Yes.
I didn't know that. That's cool.
Basically, the ML model is we're binding certain arguments to known values, and they don't have to be the first arguments either. So we just say these are the arguments we really have.
Cool.
So it's actually more flexible than the ML style. Now, this is not independent sensitive. It doesn't have to, you don't have to indent the definition.
The indentation does matter.
Okay.
I don't think it matters in this particular example.
Probably not, because you have this practice.
Yeah, like, so if I did this, that wouldn't be legal. Those kind of have to be lined up. It's probably legal. I don't know. I can try compiling it, right? Save it, compile it. Yeah, so that looks kosher.
Because it knows the...
Yeah, but that will definitely be illegal. It'd be like, yeah. What? That started at the beginning of the line. Like, what'd you just do, right? So it's somewhat forgiving, but there are some rules to it. Yep. So cool. We can draw broken clocks, and so that pretty much covers like this idea of, well, what are all the primitives in the standard library of making things appear on the screen? And you can see you can get pretty complicated with this. And I didn't even go over stuff like layout. That's really where a cool story is, and I'm gonna get to that in a second, but you can kind of see the element type. We can change the width and the height. We can have things go left to right, top down, in front of each other, and all sorts of other quote spacing and positioning, centering, stuff like that. So there's some cool stuff there. So we have
buttons and checkboxes and read.
Yep. Yeah, we'll get that next. Okay, so cool. So we'll look at a couple of other examples of things that were made in Elm that are like way prettier than what I've shown you so far to show like, hey, we could do some really cool things. The first one, I guess this is a WebGL example. This is a FPS without the S, I suppose. And we're walking around in a world and we got a skybox and mouse and jumping and textures also. So I'm really happy about this because I did the WebGL library, and so and this is one of the first examples to come out. And I know other people have. Is it Jeff who's making the, or is it someone on the list is making a whole 3JS equivalent with like lighting and shadows and everything? So I'm pretty excited about that. I don't know the state of that. Busy at work, but so there's. WebGL. And one of the cool things about WebGL is we have this just like inline GLSL.
Bigger font.
Yeah, you got it. We have this inline shader language that you could put in there. And then the compiler, just for GLSL, will actually look at the types of the GLSL and throw that into the type signature of your shader. So you can see that this. If you're familiar with GLSL, and if you're not, don't worry about it, but if you're familiar with OpenGL and the language that you use to write shaders, we can see that, oh, we have a 4x4 matrix for the uniform, and we have a three-dimensional vector for the varying, and so we can kind of use this as we hook up our shaders in our shader pipeline to make sure everything plays nice with types and everything. If we have time in the end, I'll definitely go back to this in more detail. But otherwise, I think the function... And I'll just go to my page to show you why WebGL plays so nicely is because there's a function, like this is the whole library, there's a function called WebGL, which takes, which gives you an element, right? And so once you have this, like, once you have this WebGL container with its dimensions and its list of things to draw, like just like collage, right? Here are the dimensions of the things. Here are the things that know how to render themselves in an OpenGL context. You get an element which you can like put stuff on top of, like you can design your HUD using the other primitives, or you can flow it in your page or whatever. So, or you can make three of them, you know. I think testing. Right, so once you bring it up to the element, it can play well with the rest of the language, and so that's pretty cool. So that was example number one. Example number two uses, so who here is familiar with Virtual DOM? Has heard of it? Who has, or what about Facebook's React? Right, so it's this idea of every time something in your model changes, you recompute the entire view. And then you say, okay, well, what's currently on the screen, and what's my new thing on the screen, and then you diff them, and then you just apply those changes, right?
That's how Cursus works.
Does it?
Yeah.
Neat.
It figures out the difference between what you said.
It's currently
and
on the terminal, and then.
Yeah, exactly.
So, old ideas become new ideas. There you go. So you have so the virtual DOM is an implementation of this after Facebook released React. Some guy was like, oh. I don't know, maybe they didn't like Facebook or something. So he wrote virtual DOM that could be called, and so we hooked into that and provide an interface for building an HTML virtual DOM as just a Elm value, right? And so we have the similar declarative constructors to build up bigger and bigger things of HTML, and then you just throw it to this thing, and virtual DOM does all the rendering. It's actually faster than the one we have built in, and so we may just rewrite everything in virtual DOM. Don't quote me on that. I don't know if that's happening or not. Yeah, I am zoomed in a little bit. And so here is, so there's a couple things I want to show in DreamWriter. This is the actual application. And it's just like an editor that looks really pretty and has some stuff. And I think you can add new chapters and kind of pop in between. I have no idea how this works. I found this today and it looks really cool, so I was going to show it. And then it has some type ahead stuff, I guess. So it's probably someone's cool school project. I think it syncs with Dropbox. I don't know if it works or not. But so you can make some pretty snappy, responsive things using this section of the language. I'm pretty excited about it. There are other ways to do graphics in addition to this. I'll have to shout out Spyros's D3 library, which hooks into D3.js, and very similar, gives you all the building blocks to build a D3. I don't know anything about D3. You want to give it a plug?
It's basically like virtual DOM before virtual DOM existed.
There you go. Right, so just another way for data visualization is I think a strong point, and so you can use it for that. And so those are the big ones, and from there, one of my side projects would be integrating Bootstrap, Twitter Bootstrap, with the virtual DOM to give you all those things and give you a function like accordion. Right. If anyone's used UI Bootstrap, which is the AngularJS, it'd be something along those lines, give you those kind of modules. So a pretty cool story about like how you can do graphics in Elm. There are the similarities between the different renderers, if you will, is that they're all immutable data. They're all little constructive, declarative building blocks to get you a bigger thing. But yet they have their advantages of choosing one or the other. Okay, cool. So that's only the half of it. Now it's time to talk about reactive. So Elm is reactive. One of the first blog posts about this style was callback hell, right? If you've used JavaScript, they're like, you got your stuff, you got these events. When the event happens, run this function, which might do other things or might make a call and come back, and you have to you got all these big nested functions and everything.
Verbed control, we hate some verbed control.
Right, exactly. And so it's like, well, how do I deal with all these events that are flying every which way, and I got to control all of it? And so the high level is FRP, functional reactive programming, is control flow for events. That's like the tagline that we've been using recently. And just like while loops and for loops are control loops for like jumps and go-tos in assembly, we claim that FRP gives you a similar amount of like abstraction over events. It gives you a really clean, predictable, easy to reason about way to think about events and event streams and whatever. And the base of it all is this type called a signal. A signal, a value of type signal is actually a value that varies, changes over time. So it's kind of what I have right now. And a good example of that is the mouse position. It's a signal of a pair of integers. So, you know, the mouse, I'm moving my mouse around. It's not hooked up to anything right now. It will be, I think, in the next demo. But you can see, like, oh, the mouse is moving. Like, it changes over time. And where is the mouse right now? Would I want to write a program that, and in Elm, you know, what I draw depends on where the mouse is right now. You can think of, like, places that would be useful. So that's the idea of a signal. And that's the first abstraction. The second idea is we want to transform signals. If I have a signal of a pair of integers, how do I get it to like a signal of what's on the page? And so, well, this is a function, or this is a type, pair of integers, and then all the way at the bottom I've got elements. If I've got a function from pair of integers to elements, then I can get something, a signal of elements. So the main thing here is lift, A, I, or B. If I have a function from A to B, and I got a signal of A's, I get a signal of B's by basically applying this function every time the input signal changes. I get the new output signal. The intuition is like mapping. Like if you have a list and you want to map a function over a list, same thing. It's like mapping over an event stream. But you can forget about the events, right? Because this is control flow for events. It's just you're transforming the signal in real time, or however you want to think about it. It's a flexible abstraction in that it doesn't have a tight definition, but that's the idea. You want to be able to change your signal like this. And it actually, there's like lift 2, which takes the function from A to B to C, which takes two signals and combines them into a signal C. We have all the way lift 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Slight step out into theory, these are called applicative functors. And so that's what we provide. Right, so signals are applicative functors. Step back down. We provide a way for you to combine multiple signals that all change, use a function that combines them into one output signal. So.
I've got a question.
Yeah, sure.
So most of these concepts, like the one you did a very good job of explaining, aren't that difficult to understand? Why all the jargon?
Because it comes from math.
Right, and that's why I said, like, if you're...
Because it's invented by academics who need to justify their jobs.
Everyone has an opinion on this, I think, is the safest way to say it, right? And so people who are familiar with doing it, particularly if you're coming from Haskell, like, these terms will be familiar. If I say that, it'll click, oh, that's what that is. If it's not, you can ignore that, and you're able to... The fact that you're able to ignore that is, I think, what makes Elm strong, is that, like, yeah, like... So kind of mapping over a collection is kind of in the vernacular of most programmers now, so that's a good analogy. Functor probably isn't, and that's okay, because we're providing it so that, you know, everyone, it's accessible to everyone, but then there's also like a nice theoretical underpinning that says, oh, well, this is kind of why we designed it this way, right? So I think that's where the distinction is.
I think there's one of the things that I found particularly annoying coming from the other direction without, in the sense, being informed by, say, logic, mm-hmm. is that people kind of do things any of the how, and you get constructions that are idiosyncratic, whereas if they come from a formal underpinning, then the idiosyncratic nature is bled out of it, so that it has a very clear logical reason for being.
I think that fits with my opinion of this whole thing, and I'll switch to my opinion, is that let's go to the Haskell world and use Haskell and lean on it to design our abstractions. But once we built the abstraction, make it in a way that's so easy to understand that we don't have to think about it anymore. So use it as an source of inspiration or design guide, but not, we don't have to expose it in terms of that always. Haskell does that usually. Everything that can be a functor is a functor, right? And you can use it that way. And it's useful to have that in Haskell, but here it's not so important, I think, is the argument. And so, and accessibility is really the biggest, you know, we want to have as many people be able to use it. Yeah.
I have a question about the two.
Sure.
So you, I guess, is that similar to thinking of it as taking two signals as parameters and outputting a signal?
Yeah, that's pretty much, I'll go to the definition of it, and then I'll explain what it does. But I think what you're saying is largely, let's see, string.
Okay, so that's sort of the building block for my one question, which is, if you take in two parameters and one changes twice as frequently as the other, how do you handle
it? Yeah. So, whenever either of the inputs change, it will recompute the output. So if only one of them changes, or if they both change, and there's this idea of like, well, they all change in lockstep. So if they both change during the same step, then the output will change. If only one of them changes, the output will be recomputed using the newest value from each of the input signals,
okay,
respectively.
So it sort of computes the output signal from scratch, just that only one of the signals actually.
Yep. Yeah, so whenever either one changes, it recomputes the new one, and then anything downstream similarly will get recomputed. Yeah.
In principle, the compiler can prove that the result doesn't matter, then, of course, it can optimize that out. For example,
yeah.
If you're multiplying two signals and you know that one is zero, you don't have to do much.
Right, yeah, and there's a lot of ways you could probably optimize that. I don't know how much of that we're doing, but there is... rife with opportunities to optimize a lot of these things. For example, if you have, would you rather compose two functions and put them in one signal transformer, or would you transform two signals sequentially? Like, yeah, they're always equivalent, but which one's faster and which one has the better memoization, maybe, right? And so it's an interesting question, an interesting problem. I don't know how much we've looked at it yet.
Do you in fact memoize?
The actual implementation is largely outlined in Evan's thesis. It's called this concurrent functional reactive programming. And so it's change messages that are sent from each signal to its downstream signals, and it gets propagated all the way through. And currently we're not doing any optimizations of like if it's like a fresh value, but the value hasn't changed, the semantics are important to still propagate it all the way through.
Right, but I was actually talking about, you know, this signal is either true or false.
Uh-huh.
You could just remember the true and false answers once you've computed them and never have to compute them again.
Yeah, well, so if we know a signal will never change, like a
not
constant
never
signal,
change, but
if it's one or the other, or
if you've already seen this configuration of signal values before,
I see. Okay, so no, so it's not memoized in that that manner. Yeah, okay. Maybe memoized was a bad word to use, because it has a very specific meaning that we're not doing.
Okay.
thank you for catching me. Yeah. So let's see. So let's figure out where we are. Okay, so we know how to transform signals, and we know that transform signals isn't just Lyft. We also have this idea of Lyft 2 and a whole bunch of other ways, like merge, like when either one of them changes, take the newest of both signal, and that's why the type is actually the same. They have to be the same. And similarly, a whole bunch of ways. Oh, and this is the next one. We'll get there. So so what is the memoization story? You do it manually. Oh, one example before we get there. So we want to follow the mouse. I have a function from a pair of integers to an element, right? A function that takes some integers and gives you something I can display. And I'm going to make a container with those dimensions. And in the middle of that container, I'm going to print as text, the mouse is here. Pretty simple. Let's head back to that. All right, so there you go. And so that's that function from type A, pair of integers, and type B is element. I'm going to use this function lift to...
And wait, why is it moving around with the mouse?
Right here. And so this thing, you can think of right...
That's why it updates, but mm-hmm. Why does it move? Why does the text move with the mouse?
Right, okay, so we've got the mouse position is the signal, we're lifting this guy, and so every time this input signal changes, the output signal, represented by this expression, changes. Its type is signal element. And so now main is not just element, it's signal element.
Yeah.
And so now we're saying, okay, the display is a value that we can draw that changes over time. That's what line 9 says, a value that changes over time that we can display. And its implementation is the result of transforming the mouse position by this function. And the way we transform the mouse position, a pair of integers, to a value that we can display is through using this function. And so we're basically, whenever the mouse position changes, this container gets bigger. You can imagine like a rectangle whose dimensions are where my mouse is, and that text is just in the middle of that rectangle. I can make this a little bigger.
The mouse.position is not a tuple of ints, it's a signal, right? So it's
right.
Extremely...
Yep, I'll give you guys this. Right. The mouse position isn't a pair of integers. It's a pair of integers that changes over time. It's a signal of a pair of integers. And so we can transform this signal into a new signal by using...
Okay, the answer to my question is that that's because that's what the arguments x and y container need.
Okay, yeah, okay, got it.
You get that.
Yep, yeah, so container is a function that takes a width, a height, a place to put its contents, and something, and the thing to put inside of it.
Okay.
And I can go that. Yep, good.
So would it be fair to say that if you took the X and Y after container and hard coded them, it would stop moving, but then you wouldn't be able to show as text anymore?
Yeah, I mean, if we did this, we can hard code the width and just the height would change, I think, right? So width doesn't change, now the height changes. And so the width is always 100. We should make that 500 so we can actually see it. So there we go. And at that point, but the X position is actually still shown in the text.
Yeah. So if you change it to 500, 500, then the text will hold still.
Mm-hmm.
Just as content will show.
Right. Cool. So
there
you
go. That's probably what most of us were sort of
expecting.
Thinking, expecting.
Yes. Yeah. I threw a curveball on all of you. That's right.
This is very clear now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can play around with that. Let's see how we would do that.
What's the default layout?
And put an outline around the container so we can visualize it.
Okay, we'll get there.
I'm high maintenance, sorry.
No, that's cool. We'll put all this in there because it's pretty quick. So this is live coding now. Everyone get excited. Border. By setting the color of the container, you can create borders. Okay, great. So color. We'll give this a color red, just a just get rid of that little infix signal is to get around precedence. It just sets the precedence that compute all this first and then pass it as an argument to this. That's all that is. And then we'll do color black container 400 middle empty, just to give us a well, we'll make that smaller. And then we'll put that back to X and Y, see if it compiles. Expected M. Yep. There we go. Right? So we have a red container inside of which we're displaying the real-time mouse coordinates. The size of the red container is exactly where the mouse is, right? That's clear. And then to the right of it, there's also a 100 by 100 black container. There you go. This is absolutely why I love this language, right? You can do stuff like this. cool. So, yeah. Yeah. And where does that come from? Why does this happen? Declarative graphics, and functional reactive programming. That's it. That's it. Really, really simple primitives that give you this kind of expressiveness. Expressivity?
Yeah.
Expressivity. Yeah.
Is it all in the signal? Like, if you didn't have signal, it would just be static.
That's right, yeah. For example, there is a signal, there's something called constant, which gives a signal that doesn't change, for example. And then also I could just say, well, display 400, and similarly, it's just gonna be without any signals at all, right? But then I'll pull all those back in for GitHub. Line 8,
yeah.
Sure.
So, as text mouse, is that a function you pass into the fourth parameter of a container? Is that what that is?
Yep, let me get rid of all this. And so, okay, so this concatenates two strings. Well, actually, this turns this into a string. We concatenate it. We now have a string. As text takes actually anything and turns it into an element. So, it's like a super show, if you will. So now we have an element. Now, element, yeah, this whole expression is the fourth argument to container. So we have a container, dimensions of the mouse position, its contents are in the middle, and there's like top middle, bottom middle, left middle, top right, left right, all that. So this is now another element, and then we make it red. And we have also this other one, and then flow right puts a list of elements either side by side or vertically based on this argument. So we're going to make them to the right of each other sequentially. And now this is a function, pure function, right? That takes its dimensions and does all this cool stuff, all the rendering. You know, just like clock, pure functions. A little bit of configuration to make a form, a little bit of configuration to make a clock, right? So pure function, and then all we're doing is lifting this pure function onto a value that changes over time to get a new value that changes over time. Our new value is of type, well, the thing that's changing over time is now an element, and so we can display it, and that's game.
The lift function, that's taking the signal?
Yeah, so lift is our signal transformer. Yeah, and so lift is how we take pure functions and turn them into and transform an input signal into an output signal. Yep. And the value of this expression is itself, it's the definition of the function, right? So it's a signal of element, yeah. That's the special sauce. Yeah, yeah, I think was your question.
Can you flip back to the clock for a moment?
Sure.
Okay, now, what are these forms? I missed that.
What's the difference between form and element? I talked to Evan about this. There's basically two ways you would want to talk about positioning. One of them is layout, and the other one is coordinates. And so forms are basically things you would want to do in a coordinate space, and elements are basically things you want to do in like a next to, above, in a container, middle sort of things. And so layout. So the biggest difference between forms and elements is how you put them next to each other. And so then the question is, well, why are shapes and lines forms? Because usually you want them to be like at an exact spot or something.
So this works because all these objects are centered on the center of the collage.
Yes.
And
yeah.
We don't actually say that. It's just.
That's the default, right?
Okay.
So we could actually, I guess, like, move X 50. I don't know. It might work. Yeah. So
yeah.
We just shifted that guy over, right?
Just as a real quick, this is not implemented using signals. Right?
Correct.
But you could.
That's right. Yeah, and so now we'll actually go straight to the example on the website, but I think it's just like this. I don't know what it is. We could. You know what? We'll just do that instead, because I don't know what. So we'll just do like a huge number plus mouse dot position times, because I think it's like milliseconds or something.
Yeah,
I'm not allowed to do this. It's yelling at me. We'll just go with what's the example on the website.
Position.x is good.
So mouse position is a. So we actually have to. Yep.
Yeah,
because
it's a tuple, so you have to get out there.
So we're just going to quickly define a lambda to make the function we actually want to lift.
Yeah.
Right? Just make sure our precedence is good. Let's see if we got there. Import the mouse. Oh, to int. Oh, to float, actually. Precedence, come on. And now what? Someone help me out.
Did you say 1000.0 or something on those lines?
No, we shouldn't. So I'm missing a signal. Oh, yeah, main is a signal now. Well, so we'll just comment out the type annotation because we don't need it.
Oh. You can get rid of all the type annotations?
Yeah, they're not required. So that's the thing. The type inference will actually be able to handle it. Though they are nice documentation, so that's why I generally put them in there. Well, that's not true. When I was writing this morning, I didn't put the type annotations in, and then I put them in for tonight. But yeah, no, they're not required. The compiler will figure out that, oh yeah, this is now a signal of elements. So, and similarly, it knows all the types of these functions.
Can you do the usual, colon T for types and colon I for info?
Okay, so I think the larger question is there a repo for Elm that gives you type information? I don't know. I've never used the repo. We have one. You haven't either?
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
It exists, and I think you can do stuff like that. Like, what's the type of this function? I've never used it. It doesn't fit in my particular development workflow. But yeah, but it's probably you could do it. And so I think if we go to the example of this clock of how it actually works, and it's not connected to the mouse,
just
that.
Just a real quick question.
Mm-hmm. Where did I go? I'm just curious what the name of like the clock actually is. If I have internet. If I don't. Wait, I just got there. So we're actually every second. That's it. And so I guess we're multiplying by 1,000 or something. Or maybe not. I don't know. Second is probably something we know how to deal with. So second is a signal of time, which is probably just an alias for floats. And so every second we'll get a float representing, I don't know, the Unix epoch or something. And maybe it's since, I don't know. But that's another signal of values because the current time changes over time and we can get that by sampling it every certain amount of time.
UTC time, isn't it?
Let's just check.
Question about form and element.
Yep. You need collage to turn a collection of forms into an element. And then, if you really want to get crazy, there is a way to put an element inside of a form, which is even still weird to me because you can't really like draw it to the canvas. It just actually does the positioning for you. So form doesn't necessarily mean on a canvas. It actually just means this is how we're going to position it. It's probably somewhere on there. Or maybe it's in, it's called toForm. Yeah, and then you can turn any element back into a form. And the way to use this is like if you have a GIF or something that you want to be able to position in your scene, just like with your circles and your arrows. And
where's paragraph, from? The
paragraph on the back of each one. That's what I was going with. It's too close to Thanksgiving. That's funny. All right. So that's how largely the reactive story for Elm. And yeah, this was cool. This is what I was hoping for. These kind of questions. So that's what we can do, following the mouse. All right. So the final one is kind of memoization, but it's actually just like keeping track of state in the program, which is an important thing. If I want to have like not really MVC, but if I want to have a model, I want that to be able to not just be entirely dependent on input signals, right? Because so far we've only described, here are my inputs and let's get the output signal. We actually kind of want to say, okay, well, as my inputs change, let's update some sort of model. Who's familiar with folds as far as we're talking about lists? Okay, so hold on to that intuition. We have a function called fold p. The p is the past. We're going to fold over the past. And so we have a function that takes just a to b to b. Don't worry about that. It could be anything. And some b, a input signal, and you get an output signal. Okay, so what does this mean? We have a function that takes a new signal and my current, a new value and my current value, and computes my new value. So a new input value, my current saved value, and it computes my new saved value. So A is the input types and B is the saved types. I get an initial saved value, what do I start with? And then I get a signal of A's. It's a input value that changes over time. And then whenever the input value changes, we apply this function from the input value and our current saved value, we get our new saved value, and the result, our saved state. What is the saved state? The saved state is a value that changes over time. So the current value of our saved state is our output signal. So
okay, so B is the C.
Yep.
A to B to B is
so this is our input.
Transformation.
Yep, this is our step function or our update
and the
function.
The signal is the collection you're folding over.
Yep. Yeah, okay. Yeah. So this is like, in this case, fold P kind of acts like an event stream. So whenever the input signal changes, we recompute our saved value and we have our output signal. And so a really great example of that is the counter. We have an increment function, A to B to B. A, we just ignore, and we take our saved state and we increment it. We ignore the input, we take a saved state and we increment it. And then we want to fold our increment function, starting with 0, over every time I click the mouse. And so this mouse.clicks is, well, it doesn't really matter, so I'm not even going to tell you. A mouse just clicks is some data that you get every time I click the mouse. And that signal changes over time. And so then, well, every time I get a new value from the mouse click, which represents I clicked the mouse, we're going to update our saved value by 1. And then finally, we're just going to use asText as a pure function to change our number into something we can put on the screen. We've seen this before. Nope. And counter. So that's it. I'm clicking, click, 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 click. And so that's it. That's the whole story. You can get huge with this, right? So if you've ever written a game, you have like a game loop of like, okay, check all my inputs, what's changed, okay, update myself, and then render the screen. Like full P makes sense for games like, 30 times a second, FPS 30 or whatever. See what my inputs are. That's some stuff. Apply that to my model of what the game looks like. Okay, that's my new model. Render the scene. And then wait for the time tick to go off again, right? And so that's kind of where you would use fold P. But you can use it wherever, anytime you have an input value, an event external from your program, maybe something, you did some HTTP call and it came back. We do have AJAX, and I'm not going over that today. So anytime you want to be able to respond to an event and save that somehow and wait for your next couple events to come through, you'd use fold P. It's a way to update over a stream of input data.
So you said you're not going to go over it, that's fine, but mouse.clicks is an integer?
So mouse.clicks is actually a signal of unit, unit type, the type with no data, right? And so, but because you get a fresh one each time you click the mouse, we this like this fires, right? This event thing or the state updater triggers, you can think of it that way. It's interesting because when I say when the input value changes, it's not really the most precise way to talk about it. Really the say would be whenever I get a fresh input value, whenever the runtime says that this is new, right? Or and remember, FRP is control flow for events. But actually for this one, we got to kind of think of, oh yeah, these are events under the hood. So it's a little bit of bleeding abstraction. But
okay, I'm having trouble with this.
Sure.
Increment takes two parameters, ignores the first one and increments the second one.
Yep.
Okay, so you have full P, increment zero, mouse clicks. Is that partially applying zero to increment and then streaming mouse clicks?
No, those are really the three arguments. So increment is the full function. Zero is where you start.
Yeah, so increment, this function, A to int, is this one here. So we're just teaching the fold, is whenever you get your new value, this is the function you use to change your state.
Okay.
Zero is the state you start with, and mouse clicks is your input stream. Whenever the mouse clicks changes or whenever we get a new mouse click, we will apply this function to the state we're saving, and we'll get the new one.
Okay, zero is the state you start with.
Yep.
But zero is the number you start with, not a state.
I mean, it makes sense when I look at the output, but I understand how zero on mouse clicks works. Sorry.
Yep.
Well, change the zero to 100. Yeah, so watch it. Count from 100.
Yeah, sure. So I can start from here, and then I'll increment by 5. And we just see, like, the initial state of the program, right? So this thing changes over time. What is the value of counter when the program starts? It's 100. And then every time I get a new event, so I'm going to click now. I clicked, and so now it's 105. I'm going to click again.
So the part I'm really struggling with
sure.
is the underline. Like, how is the 100?
Oh, yeah, sure, start? Sorry.
Yeah, I understand it's ignored. Uh-huh. That's why I don't understand why 100 is applied.
Got it, yeah. So.
Or is it because it's the save? Like, it's ignored the first time, and then it's the save going.
Right, so. So when we had lift, we just kind of had an input signal, a function, and then an output signal. Fold P is actually an input signal, a box that we hold a value, and an output signal. The output signal is the value of the thing in the box that changes over time. And then whenever the input signal fires, we're going to apply this function and update what's in the box. And now the new thing in the box is going to be the result of applying this function to what used to be in the box and the new value.
So 100.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's n, like it's like what is n when it starts.
Yep. So that's the thing in the box we start with, and then how do we change the thing in the box? Well, we have a function that takes the inputs, then the current thing in the box, and tells us what the new thing in the box should be. That's what this function.
So it ignores the unit, which is the initial input.
Right. Yeah.
And you have the a, so that it satisfies the type.
Yeah, this could be any type, right?
Right, but in the sense of like you would ask, like if it's any type and I'm ignoring it, why is it even there? Because
right.
It has to satisfy.
So we could actually, I mean, we don't need any of these types, right? This is just to give it the most. I wonder actually if I did this, if I said, oh, it's the unit type. I wonder if the compiler would actually. Okay, so no, the compiler doesn't say, oh, your type annotation could be more general.
Yeah, that's more
reasonable. What if you wanted to change it to display the mouse position?
I'll get to you right after. You want to have this display the mouse position? Yep.
Because it's a signal.
Yes. Yeah, okay, so I'm not going to write it in the interest of time, but there's an idea of sample on, which takes two input signals. And whenever one signal changes, you take a snapshot of the other signal, and that's the value, right? Can you see how that's being used?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So there's this idea of sample on, which we can, and so that would be a good one to, like, every time the game loop tick fires, we take a sample of all of our inputs and use that and then we can.
So all of these signal typed functions are hard coded in the system.
Yes,
right?
That's a key thing. There is a set of signal combinators that the language provides. I'm going to get to what is your question?
Oh, so I was just going to say that I think maybe the confusion was if you're not familiar with like higher order functions, it looks like maybe the hundreds passed an increment, which you would say it's ignored, but rather.
Yep, so fold P here takes three arguments, increment 100. Yeah.
And it's not passed an increment,
it's passed a fold.
It's
passed a fold, which then passes an increment.
It's the whole magic of what fold P is doing here.
Right.
Would it be fair to say that fold the P and fold P stand in this case for previous value?
Yeah, whatever you want to think of it. I think we called it past, but yeah.
It's actually previous and future. It gives you the God's eye view in which you already know what all the clicks will be from the beginning of time to the end of time. That's
right.
A collection, and you just fold over that collection like
exactly.
A list or a vector or any other.
Exactly, yeah.
On line 6, where are the implicit parentheses? Are they around the two ends, or are they around A and N?
Yep, that's really the type signature, right. Increment is a function that takes something that we're going to ignore, then gives you a new function from ints to ints. Yeah, so if you want to think of it that way. So this is basically the crux of partially applying functions. In all cases, the associativity of arrow is to the right? I don't know.
It's right to left.
Right to left, yeah. So that's the way this is your equivalent. Yep. I don't really know if it's to the right or to the left.
Everybody,
that's
everybody
the way it
reads
works.
This as a comma in gets to him and ignores the fact that they're all arrows.
Mm-hmm.
The real model is everything but the last are the arguments and the last one is the result.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's see where we were. I wonder how many more slides I have. Any other questions before we move on? No, sorry. I kind of made that tough. Okay, so the final thing we're going to look at are inputs and just a handle. Because like the DOM has these things called buttons and fields and everything, which we would want to get, right? And so you may have noticed that up here this says demo.elm. Like, yes, the whole presentation has been in Elm, and so we have ways to talk about. Oops. All right. So I wrote this presentation in Elm, and you can see I didn't test it, so this is kind of large, right? But we have a way to do inputs and buttons, and we have a pretty good story. So all the way over here is the presentation that I've been giving, right? The content of it is just a list of strings, and so up here we should be able to understand how this works from now. With the minor caveat of we don't know what inputs are, but we have defined a type, a finite set of values called top, next, previous, and last. You notice that those are the buttons, right? And we're going to create something called an input. It has a type input, and an input gives you two things: a signal of like all the you kind of think of it as an event handler, all the events that it caught from things that have attached to it, and then a handle, which we can attach to things in our view. And we'll get there. So we're going to first write a function goto that takes a pres control event, if you will, and our current page and gives us the new page. And so top puts us all the way to the first slide, last puts us to the last slide, and previous and next just plus or minus, right? So pure function, take a signal control value of presentation control and tell us what the new page should be based on the old page. Okay, the header here is flowing to the right, four buttons, and so the button takes a handle. All right, so when we click this button, where should the event go? It goes up to this input. A value, when we click this button, a value, the value previous, which is of type pres control, will be sent there. And then, what's this text in the button that's previous? We have four of those, and then we're also just going to throw like what the current page is. And so that is a function header, which gives us what's the current page and an element, a component of our view, which is the four buttons. And so you can see that's up here. And then below that, how do we display? So we're going to take the current page and give the whole element. Okay, well, we're first going to put the head, we're going to flow down. And on first thing is the header, right, applied to the current page. And then the next thing is this big, I could have made this cleaner, but we have a container of size with 700 and 500, its contents are in the middle, and its contents are the result of flowing down, the result of mapping centered text of size 32, which we actually get from strings. And then, well, what do we actually put in there? Well, drop is list.drop. So we're going to drop the first n pages of our contents. And if that gives us the empty string, we know we have no more slides left, and we'll do the end of the presentation. Otherwise, we'll put the slide there. And so it all type checks because I've been doing the presentation using this code. And so we can see that we're actually not going to get to this. But we can go all the way to the first slide, right, left. And so how are we hooking this up? Well, fold p is the result of, so we save slide 0. Slide page number 0 is our initial state. How do we update our current page? Well, we use our function goTo, which takes a input value, our current page, and gives us the new page. And then we have a input signal, which is the signal of all the presentation controls. And you'll notice that all these buttons send their events to presentation control. So if we click top, what's happening? We clicked top. A value of top got sent to the pres control signal, which triggered the function goTo, incrementing the value here, and so the current page is just a integer that changes over time. This is being recorded, so I'll you guys can go through that.
And what does it mean, pres control.handle?
So pres control, the type input, is actually a record with two things. The handle, which you attach to things in your view, and the signal, which you use to wire up your program.
So is the handle kind of a receiver for signals that sort of collects them into the
signal? I wouldn't say it's a receiver of signals, but it's like this,
what's its type? Is it it's another element?
A handle is just a handle, actually.
I see. So you pass that to button, and that's white, and then you get an element from that.
Yeah, so here it is. These are the big things, right? So a handle is a combination of two things, the current value of, or the last event we got, and a place to which we can send events from the view. That's the handle itself.
It's a receiver of events.
Yep, and how do we create an input? We just give it an initial value, and we get an input. Because all signals have to have an initial value, kind of below the line detail. But essentially, we can only create handles by instantiating them together. And so you, when you call input, you get both at the same time. You get a place to send events from your view, and also a signal that represents all those events that you've got. And so that's how you can build your view still using pure functions, just by using these handles, but then actually eventually just lift it and make it reactive based on that. So this is the answer to, like, well, where are all my callbacks, right? Where are all my on-clicks and my on-load or whatever? But yeah, mostly the on-clicks or on-change or on, what's it called when you leave? On-blur, right? So that whole story is all implemented through this handle thing. This input thing, which is relatively new. It's like only like a half a year old that we replaced our handle input.
In the standard library, it'll be, it's existed in other libraries pretty easily.
Like Tim doing that?
Somebody did the handle thing. I did a version of it as well.
You did it too? Okay. So this is one of these like evolved, like we had a really bad story for inputs we used to, and now this is like way cleaner. So we have the current page is a value that changes over time. We have display, which is just a way to turn it into there, which includes some buttons which know how to call home to the input. And so we're going to lift that over. Sorry, that was like bouncing off the walls, but like. So the display depends on the current page, but the display also includes things which can update what the current page is, and so that's how you get like this.
World's smallest PowerPoint program.
Yeah, it might be. Yeah, right. And so you can see, like, I that's it. Like everything else below here doesn't count for lines of code because it's actually what's in the slideshow. I actually could have put that in another file and just like magic slideshow. It takes a list of strings and gives you an element. So that's like largely that. I was gonna do one more. I was gonna make a. I was actually worried that I was not gonna have a lot of content, but this was actually really exciting. This is something I did actually to demo this for folks at work. We made a Turing machine, which very similar to this, had a couple of buttons where you could move the tape, and you could mark it or erase it. So it was pretty fun. But yeah, I think that's largely it. So does anyone have any other questions?
What is it
doing
under the hood?
What is it doing under the hood?
Does it convert to JavaScript and that
one? Oh, okay, yeah. So if really important parts. Oh, there's so much other things I would want to talk about. Under the hood, this gets compiled to HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And the Elm compiler is just an executable that runs and does that. How am I running this? Yeah, there's a lot of different answers to this.
The compiler is running in JavaScript too?
The compiler is written in Haskell.
Okay.
So it's
not running in the browser.
Correct. What I actually have is here this thing called Elm Reactor, which I run in a directory, and it serves the directory of Elm files, and then whenever I change it, it recompiles it, and we'll do that. So that's how I've been doing this sort of like live code. Like again, this is this background program which you can get from the installer. It's an MSI or a, what are you guys using
DMG.
Mac world? DMG. We have DMG also for that. It includes this thing called Elm Reactor, which yeah just watches a directory and you refresh the page and it recompiles it. Such a nice workflow, right? You can replace this with any editor you want. Sublime, Emacs Vim. I still use Vim. Right, so okay, so that's one answer to under the hood of like how it compiles and like what it actually becomes. And then it's just like a big like spaghetti event thing that we just generate. The compiler generates it, right? You don't have to deal with it. So that's largely how that.
Can you also pre-compile it to set a JavaScript
file? How to what?
Can you also pre-compile it to set a JavaScript
file? Yeah, right. Okay, good question. And so we'll embed the runtime and your compiler in just like a .js file, and we do have a good story for interop. We have this. So let's say you already have an HTML page, right? And you wrote a little program in Elm, main equals signal element or whatever, and you want to put that. Yeah, something was wrong with the internet. Oh, we're good. This is the sauce right here, right? So you just load that JavaScript file in, and you say elm.embed, elm.stamper into whatever div you got by your regular old get element by ID, right? And so that way you can design your whole page, you can give it a div, you can use CSS to say, oh, like, this is how big it is, and you just put like an Elm program right in there, right? And so that's it. Furthermore, you can create signals both at the top of your program and at the bottom of your program. We call those ports. At the top, you can use JavaScript to programmatically send messages to Elm, and those become signals that change over time. And at the bottom of your Elm program, you can register a callback function in JavaScript to change whenever something in Elm changes. So you have both input signals and output signals that can be exposed to JavaScript when you embed Elm into a larger HTML application.
So here you have Elm. So
yep.
you're sending embedded this to my Elm program. Is that what Stamper is, or Stamper something else?
Yeah, so Stamper would be like, let's say you compiled something and it was like module Stamper.
Okay.
So then this would be called elm.stamper, and so here you go. What's the module prefixed with? So that's where it comes in. That's just like the name that comes out of it at the bottom. And then, yeah, and similarly ports. These are all on the Elm webpage. You go to learn, and you can go through... largely everything I talked about. We have a lot of like patterns and boilerplate things.
Is there a server-side story yet?
No. Theoretically, you could take Elm, compile it to JavaScript, run it in Node, but it's not like... You can do it if you wanted to. But no one's really using it for anything. And particularly, like, FRP is really good for UI. For path handlers, route handlers, and everything. It's not really the same programming model. FRP doesn't, in my opinion, translate super well into anything other than UI. And so I think pages and like user applications are the sweet spot, and everything else, like, use whatever you want. Like, use Node, use Haskell, use...
Yeah, but yeah. I don't want to use only one thing everywhere.
Wow, that's your problem.
We certainly use the pure server side, right?
Conceivably, one can build a native library that takes some function from request to response and wires that up. And yeah, you could probably do that. I've thought about doing that and just haven't really pursued it because the tooling in other server side languages. Yeah, we can get into this, but yeah, it's probably possible. No one's really doing it.
This might have been clear to everyone, but when you're doing that Elm in HTML, when you're putting it in that div, where then is that Elm that you put in that div? Is that getting executed in the browser? Like,
yep. Yeah, so either it's a static page or something that's dynamic. It's all like a self-contained signals and everything.
The whole page.
Yeah, so as opposed to just like if you compiled it with HTML, regular compile it, it turns into a full screen web application. You can compile it with this like only JS thing, and which is actually some of the command line things are going to change pretty soon in the next version. But you can compile it this way, and then you can take that resulting JavaScript file, which is output from the compiler, load that in, using a regular script tag, and then you can do this stuff in here. I think read through this page, you'll get a better explanation of how it works.
Definitely. But then in that case, you're not relying on the executable like you are doing here, right? As you are locally here.
I see. Yeah. Right. So you wouldn't be using this program.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, that executable is just the compiler. It's not happening.
Yeah, that's right. All this thing is like a nifty compiler plus web server hybrid. It's a workflow tool, but yeah, you wouldn't use Elm Reactor in production, for example. Yeah, I think that's where you're getting.
So you mentioned in the next version, and I guess that brings me to the next question, is where is Elm right now at its maturity level, so to speak, and in terms of adoption, what kind of data do you have on that?
I think the adoption is a good question. I don't really know. Evan probably has a good number of like downloads, but I don't know what we're really doing about tracking, like who's really using it, who's using it in like production. Like I'm using this at work, but for like a smaller side project, kind of pushing to like get it out there. Some people are pretty excited about it. Anyway, back to your question, where is it in terms of maturity? Yeah, it's like we went from 0.9 to 0.10 and 0.11 and 0.12, and it's like, oh, well, when is this going to become like the target? And I think we're getting close, but I don't really know the good answer for you. There's a lot of things we want to do. For example, we have like all this like public library package story, right? And so some of that, we're not using NPM, we're using our own thing. We had to build all that out. I think we want to secure down the tooling first, then maybe a handful of other like type system features, which I don't really know what's going to be in and what's going to be out. So I don't know. We could be like still a year away from like 1.0. So I don't really have a good answer for you because I don't largely know. But I think there's like on the listserv, more and more people will be like, let's get something, like let's lock it down, let's hit it, and worry about backwards compatibility. And I still don't think that's a huge priority. But so it's been 2 years, so we're probably getting close.
So you seem to, if you're generating CSS, it's supposed to be seemingly uglified CSS. I mean, not just in the way it appears, but in what it shows.
Right.
Your buttons look horrible.
They look like
Windows 3.1.
Yeah. The generated, okay, yeah. Oh, so, A, that's good feedback of, like, how are we styling our stuff? Yeah. If you use the virtual DOM stuff and embed it in your page, then you can override it, right? So there's that story.
Of course, we want it to be pretty... When you write the simple code, not
that's right.
When you write the simple code.
Yeah, and so I think you can style the buttons somehow. I don't know.
This guy did.
Yeah, this guy used virtual DOM, so I don't know all of his source over here, and so he probably had some sort of. What I'm really most interested in is his wrapper HTML file, and let's see how much boilerplate that is. So.
There's your.
Yeah, so here's his apps.js, here's his bootstrapping the Elm, and he looks like he has his own CSS. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So in this particular application, he's just using Elm for the FRP side of it. It's like, how much are you really trading off when you get it? And I think it comes down to, like, well, what do you want to replace? Do you want to replace all of your callbacks and everything? Like, that's one of the reasons I want to write bootstrap.elm, because then you get, like, well, okay, so... people do or do not like Bootstrap. Sure, we'll get there, right? But those are the kind of like people making component libraries, I think, is really the right answer to your question. It's like, yeah, it's going to take some time to get it, the non-standard library, really pretty widget frameworks, right? And so, and when we're talking about that in terms of the maturity question, that's also like, okay, well, we got the standard library, we got some cool ways, some cool primitives, but like, how much of an ecosystem is there? And I say it's like really young, right? And so, I think I answered kind of both your questions, maybe. Hopefully. Anyone else? All right, cool. This is really fun. That's fine.